Okay, so this will be section 2.1. We did this lecture on Friday, but as I'm going to start recording here in my little studio so that I can use some of the technology, the graphing calculator that I have on this particular desktop unit. So if you were in class, you've seen this. If you weren't, maybe you've been waiting for it. So here we go. So where we're at, this is section 2.1, which was Friday. I'm making this on Monday, the holiday, and well, hopefully I've got section 2.2 also ready to go, so you'll please do look for that as soon as that is posted, and we'll start moving into a flipped mode of learning, where I will provide the videos to you in advance. You can watch them before class, and what that will allow us to do in class, we can do a shorter review of the content and get into looking at examples and homework problems. And, hopefully that will help, looking at more how to apply it and do it, look at your questions. All right. So what we're going to do today is understanding what a derivative is using limits. And we're going to take a look at this applet. So we'll go to this applet link in just a moment. But I'll kind of highlight the parts of it here. Now, one of the things I think is unfortunate is that the slope of the tangent line, so notice the blue line is actually the secant line. It's going through 2 points on this curve. So the curve we're using is x squared plus 1. And the blue line is actually the secant line, but they say that they give you the slope of the tangent line in blue and the slope of the secant line in green. So you know, your mind has to switch here. But I would do it differently if I was doing this applet. But let's go ahead and go to the applet. So let's click on that. Let's see. It's taking just a moment. Here we go. And again, you've got access to these slides, so any of these applets you can go to yourself, and it is helpful to kind of go ahead and play with it. So I've got A and B here, and what the main thing is we're going to see is that as we slide the 2 points together, and we're going to do that with limits, that the secant line becomes a tangent line. And what we're going to see is the slopes come closer and closer to being together until, and again, we can get them as close as we need. But that's sort of how we've been playing with limits. What's nice about this is you can also change your functions. You can do a sine function. You know, how does that differ? Let's see. I can find my other point. Here we go. Not sure what that piece is, but here's a secant line. We can see that has actually a slope of 0, and so maybe you could see when you get to the bottom, the minimum or a maximum, you start playing all the tangent line, the slope is 0 or pretty close to it as we get close to it. So we're going to see, and again, as we bring the 2 points together using limits, we get that the secant line becomes the tangent line and the slopes are the same. And the slope of the tangent line is what we're going to find the derivative to be. And that's the big part we get out of calculus is the derivative. The rate of change at a point, instantaneous rate of change. Very important concept and very usable because it tells us not where we are so much as where we're going. So if we know where we are and we know where we're going, we can make predictions into the future, and that's what gives us some value to move forward. Okay, so we'll come back here, and so that's the concept we're going to go through. Slope is just the difference of the y values divided by the difference of the x values. So this slope formula that we've probably, hopefully, seen many times in an algebra class and probably used many times, this is really what calculus is all about, except For algebra, you need the 2 points. For calculus, we want instantaneous rate of change, so we bring those 2 points closer and closer and closer, and when we get our techniques for actually just taking a derivative in a short period of time, we will throw away the limit, and we'll just be able to actually say that this is what it is at a point. But we're building there, and we'll also be able to find the equation. I don't know what that was about. I didn't really read it. But we're going to get the equation of the tangent line. And notice, it builds on the slope. We use the slope. We have to find the y-intercept. Now, the y-intercept is not associated with the, or may not be anyway, could be, is not necessarily associated with the original curve, what we're going to see, but it's associated with that line. And what that gives us is the equation of the line. We can then use that line to make predictions either for future values or previous values that we didn't have. Two ways of getting a linear equation. I like using y equals mx plus b. It works great. I put in the slope. I put in one of the points, which is the tangent point that we're given. We can find the y-intercept, and then we'll have the equation of the line. There's also point slope, which that works in the same way. You put in the slope, and then you put the 2 points in, and then you do some algebra, and you've got y equals. So whichever one you're more comfortable with, you're welcome to use. Okay. So we're going to look at some examples of doing that. And we'll take this definition that the slope of a tangent line is the limit as we bring one point closer to the other. So x is some value, x is some point, a is another point, and we bring them closer together. We let x actually go to a. What we see, if I can get out of the way here, is the second one is really doing the same thing, but it focuses on the point A and a little bit more than A. So we add some distance, h, and it could be large or it could be smaller. And what we do is if we make that distance smaller and smaller, we get down to just a single point at A. So we find that this is a convenient way. Either way really works. So you can either think of x as going to some point A, or you can think of A and the second point being some distance, some slight distance from A, some whatever h is, and then we let h go to zero so that additional distance has gone to zero and they become 1 point. Okay. This one in practice ends up being the one with the h, the one we end up using more, quite a bit. But both of them will work, and so you could use either one. But again, it's just that concept from that little applet that you're bringing 2 points on a curve together. You're subtracting two y points, subtracting two y coordinates, two x coordinates from those same 2 points, and you're getting a slope. You're getting a secant line slope, an average rate of change. The closer you bring them together until they're touching, until they are the same point, then you make it an instantaneous rate of change. So the difference is on your car speedometer, that's giving you an instantaneous, how fast are you going right now. Somebody measuring your speed, even with a radar gun, they're taking 2-point measurements and they're actually getting an average speed. But it can get very close to that instantaneous rate of change if the time between the measurements is very small. So let's look at an example, and what I'm going to do is show, first of all, how to use technology to get at this, and then we'll also follow through on the question. So ball is thrown in the air, initial velocity 30 feet per second. You kind of see that in here in the equation. And then its height after t seconds is given by this formula. What you'll come to see is that this 16 t squared, 16 feet per second, is the pull of gravity, and it's always a squared, so it gives us a parabola. So this is being subtracted. So there was a force upward. This second force is a downward force of gravity, which brings it back down. So over time, time it travels, we see a parabola. Now, it could have just gone straight up and straight down. It doesn't mean that the path is a parabola, but it means the height in relationship to the time. When you graph that, it becomes a parabola. So then we want to find the average velocity when at 2 seconds. And we want, goodness, so this time we're kind of using h, and we want the second point to be successively and successively closer to 2. Okay, so this would be lasting 2.1, so that means we're going from 2 to 2.1. This means we're going from 2 to 2.01. So we see how we're getting closer here, and this last one would be 2.001. So very close to 2. Okay, so let me first of all show you a few tricks we can use with the TI calculator. Let me switch modes here. TI-84 calculator, actually. There we go. So this is a newer version. It's an electronic version on this computer. If you were in class, you saw that I used my older version, which looks a little different, doesn't have what they call the math print. This will look prettier, and probably is closer to the system that most of you are using. However, the one I'll bring to class will still be the old clunky one. So those of you who have the older version and notice something a little different, you'll still also be able to get there. So the first thing we want to do is go ahead and graph. So we come to y equals, that's where we're at. We want to put in that function, so y equals 30x minus 16x squared. Notice we're using x instead of t because that's just the variable we have in these graphing calculators. Notice down here there's a key press memory history, so you'll be able to see that as I go through. That's one of the advantages of using this system. It'll give you multiple views and such, and so hopefully you'll be able to keep up with things. So what we're going to do is first we're going to graph this. I'm not sure what my window is set at. Looks like I maybe want to change it. So what I'm going to show you, I'm going to go to what's called a zoom standard number 6, which is a negative 10 to negative 10, and y is going from negative 10 to 10. So it's going up here. I'd like to see the vertex, so what I'll do is I'll go to the window, and I'll make my, that's a y maximum, that's the top of the graph. Let's make it, I think 15 will do it. And it does, so it gets, doesn't go quite higher than 15 feet. Comes up, goes down. So first of all, I'm going to show you we can use a tool called, to get the tangent line, since that's really what we're looking for. We've talked about it. There's something called draw. So draw is right above the program key here. So I'm going to go second, since it's above it. It's in blue. I have to do a shifted function. And the draw function, I can actually draw the tangent line. So I go to number 5, or just click on number 5. And then it's asking, doesn't really say, I guess maybe it does over here. What I have to do is get what x value do I want it at? Well, the question was asking at 2. So when x equals 2, I'm going to enter. And notice now, it may be a little harder to see. Let's do this. Let's go to the window. Let's bring our x minimum and maximum in. So let's go from negative 5 to positive 5. Just help us take a look a little bit clearer. And I think the graph will be a little more out there. And so when we do our draw, again, second program, which gives us draw number 5, we'll draw the tangent line when x equals 2. And now, I maybe see it a little bit better, but it gives us, when x equals 2, that's what it's telling us, and it actually gives us the equation of the tangent line. It's a nice feature of these calculators. We've actually got it. We don't have to go through and calculate. Notice it's got a y-intercept of 64 because it's shooting way up there. It does have a negative slope, so we see we are decreasing. Of course, this problem is, we've got gone through the ground, right? We went up, we hit the ground, and we went through the ground, so I guess we had more, I don't know if it's a point of interest, but, excuse me. Anyway, for this particular problem, that's what we have. What I want to show you is how we can actually, so now that we know what our answer is, negative 34 is what it should be, and that's really, let's see, the answer, based on these results, guess the instantaneous velocity after 2 seconds, well, I would say, that's negative 34 feet per second. Again, that's what the, for this particular answer. And what we're going to see is that as we sneak up, we get closer and closer to 2, so we're going to use this. We'll get that value. I'm going to show you how to use the technology so you don't have to calculate 3 different times. Now, you could calculate 3 different times. X is 2 and the 2.1, plug it into the slope formula, and you'll get that average rate of change. The other way we can approach that, see if I can do it with this. Here we go. There we go. Is we come back to y equals, and what we're going to do is I'm going to come down a little bit further. Let's come down to y5 because I'm going to leave this in here. So once I put it in, and I'm going to put in the difference quotient using y1 as my function. So watch how I can do this. So I need a fraction, and let me clear it out the history because we're starting something new. So what I want is I want a fraction. There's a way to do that. Well, I'm just going to put a parenthesis to start off with. So what I want is I'm going to want the y value of this function. So there's this, the variables are stored under the bars key. Bars. And we want y variables. So we go here. We want function. So I'm just going to hit enter. And we want y1. So I'm going to hit enter again. So that's y1. To make it into a function, I'm going to put a parentheses. What I'm going to put in here to make it more generalized, I'm going to put x plus some amount, and this time I'm going to start with 0.1. Okay, so I've got it. There might be a fancy way to change that, but we'll see that. And then what I've got to do is I've got to subtract the y value at x, right? So I'm going to go to vars again, over to y vars, and functions is where I'm at, so I hit enter, and I want y1 again, and I'm going to go parentheses y1 at the value of x. And what I'll use is I'll use the table and go down to that x value. So I'm going to close off the parentheses. See, it was even, it looked like it kind of suggested that to me. And then I'm going to divide by what? H. And H is this 0.1. Okay, so that's the distance that I'm going away from the point. If I leave this here, anytime I enter y1, we're good to go. I can always turn this off for the future, so I'll show you how, you know, if you come over and where it says equals, if you hit enter, we just turn it off so it won't show up, but we want it to show up because we want to see what this value is. So y1 is going to be the y value of the function at any given point. Y5 is going to give us the average slope at some value of x that's on the table plus 0.1. So it's taking 2 points, the point of x that we're going to look at, plus 0.1. So what we do now is instead of going to graph, we're going to go to the table, second table. Notice y5 is actually giving us a slope. It's not giving us a y value so much. I mean, it is a y value, yes, but it's calculating a slope from y1. And so we wanted it at 2. 2, the actual y value is -4. And what we do is we calculate the slope, we came up with -35.6. Okay, so that's what it's doing there. And then we could come back over here. Let's see if this is, and we could actually put that in here. So what is the slope? It was what, negative 265.1. I think so. Go back. Maybe I got it wrong. I know it's, I think it's 35.6, so we'll maybe change that. What I'll show you is when we go back to y equals, we can now just change it slightly and find, have it calculate the slope at 0.001. What I do is I come to the 1 and I want to insert a space. And where is the insert key? It's right above the delete key. So instead of deleting, we're going to insert something, and I'll put 0.01. So 0.01, I want to put it there and here. Now you could also probably put in some variable. You could put like even h itself and then change the h variable each time. That's maybe more accurate, or well, not more accurate, both are accurate, but this is, I think this is easier because you see exactly what you've got. So what we want to insert a zero there, 0.01. And now we'll go back to the table, and it's calculated at 2. Notice it's negative 34.16. So I'm going to go write that down and change that other one to 35.6, so 34.16. Change this to a 6, and this to a minus 34.16, and notice we're getting closer to this value of negative 34, and we'll see, we'll probably get very close there when we put this one in. Okay, so we'll look at that example. Again, remember, you can always, with the videos, the advantage is you can either play them at a faster speed, or you can skip ahead as you get things that you know, or you can back things up and slow it down as you need. So that's, I found having videos, second insert, a helpful way for me to learn, because then you have a little, you have more control. Again, if you're getting it, speed it up. If you need to, slow it down, back it up. Oops, what did I do? Oh, I went to catalog. I don't want to be there. How can I undo this? Let's go back to y equals. I think I just need to go back here. Oh, I also found there's this little fraction key. I forget where it was, but it's actually alpha F1. So maybe we'll try that next time. So notice the F1 is green. Alpha F1 gives us this little menu here. I just want, let's see. Sometimes how do you get out? Let's just delete. No, that didn't help. Clear? Yeah, okay, clear. I'm back here. So I want second insert. And I want to put in a zero. If I arrow over, I see I got 0.001, and I go back to the table. And again, this is not, there's probably a more efficient way to do this, but negative 34.02, so very close to negative 34. Okay, but it's certainly, oops, not that one, this one. So this one became negative 34.02. And you'll have a problem that's similar, but the numbers are different, and you'll kind of go through these steps, and that'll help you get there. And again, if you leave that difference formula, difference equation, in Y5 or wherever you want to put it down lower, turn it on and off as you need it, but just leave it there so you don't have to keep re-entering it. Okay. So that's how we do that. And again, we also, even though it didn't ask for it, we came up with the equation of the tangent line at 2. Now that's only at 2. We're going to eventually see how it works and gets us to the actual function. But what was that? It was minus 34x plus, I think it was 64. So it got the y-intercept for us. What we would need to do is, to find that equation of a tangent line, we would just use y equals mx y was negative 4. So we plug that point in. The way I would go about finding this is y is negative 4, negative 34, when x is 2. So this becomes 68, negative 68 plus b. Add 68 to both sides, and when you do that, you end up with 68, positive 68 minus 4 gives you 64, is what b equals to, and that's what we have up here. Okay, so once you've got that, you could, I mean, if you want to go that route, going more with a by-hand calculation, which is good to review, that you're just getting the equation of a line. How to do that. Technology will do it as a check, but you can also do it by hand. Okay. So let's find the equation of the tangent line. And again, we've got a fairly simple way to do it with a calculator. This is our function, negative 8, negative 2x plus 3x squared. All we have to do now is go back. I'm going to go down to, we weren't asked to sneak up on it with limits, so I'm going to turn this graph off, y2, go up to y1. I'm going to clear it, and let's put in the equation, I think, was it minus 8? Subtract 2x, I think it was, and then, I think it was plus, 3x squared. I'll go back and check. That's what's nice about using a handheld calculator. You can have the problem sitting there right where you do it. Negative 8 minus 2x, negative 8 minus 2x, 3x squared. Okay, and we want to find it at 2. So again, all we need to do is graph it. We might need to adjust the window. It's looking good, though. At 2, we can see that's where the tangent line is going to be, and we can actually draw it in. Second, the program draw, right? Second program button. Oops, it didn't. I want to go second program. There we go, and that gives us the other one's the program. Go down to tangent, hit enter, and we find the. Oops. Go back to the graph. Second. So you got to be in the right windows. So evidently I got to the wrong window somehow. But there we are. From the graph I enter 2. And it will actually draw that tangent there. And I see the tangent. I see it's going upwards. So it's got a positive slope. And it's given to me as 10x plus negative 20. And I can see, yeah, that's going to go down here and have a y-intercept down. And negative 20. So with the technology, I've got my answer right now. So let's go ahead and put that in. And then we'll see how we might come up with it using limits. And it's been asked, I did get the, over the weekend, I did a copy of the exam. There is one question on limits that you're required to fill in step by step using limits to get a to do the difference quotient, and it's very clear if you don't use limits, you know the answer itself is not okay. You got to show that you know how to use limits. So what do we? But there are quite a few that are multiple choice. Where am I? And I see. Okay, so we came up with y equals 10x minus 20. Okay, so I'm going to use the limits to come up with the slope of 10 at the point 2. And you will need to be able to be able to do this one with an x squared. It's a little bit easier for linear equations. It's harder for rational and radicals and a lot of other ones, but be able to do something like this and you'll be just fine. So we want the limit, and we could have x go towards a, so x going towards 2, or we could have h go towards 0, and then what we do is we plug in 2 for x. Let's use that one. So we're going to do h going to 0. And in the numerator, we're going to remember we have f of x plus h minus f of x. And we're going to be able to plug in 2 there for each of those over h. And so what I do first is just to organize the work, I would do f of x plus h. And so we plug in x plus h into each of these input places where we have an x. So I'm going to rewrite this as minus 8 minus 2. And I'll call this 2x, but I'll put a big parenthesis. And I'm going to put in now x plus h in there. Not right now, but I'll go ahead and rewrite the whole formula. 3 parentheses squared. And I'm just going to change this and show that x plus h goes in here. X plus h goes in here. Switch back to color. So we get, if you bring this over, we get a negative 8. I'm going to distribute this 2 through, right? So we get negative 2x minus 2h. Get that right. Now this x plus h we have to FOIL out. So you have to take x plus h times x plus h. And then multiply all of that by 3. So let me do it this way. I'll put the plus 3. Let's put in here. X times x is x squared. You get x times h, which is xh, and another x times h, which is xh. So you got 2 of those. 2xh, right? One from here, and one from here. And then you get h times h, which is plus h squared. Now distribute the 3. And so we're going to get negative 8 minus 2x minus 2h plus 3x squared plus 6x, 3 times 2, 6. Okay, I don't know why sometimes it's probably an older computer that I have, 6. It's an old Mac Mini. 3xh, and then a 3 times h squared. But, you know, I bought this one. It's 2012, and it's still, you know, updating, working, so that's pretty good. 10-year-old computer. Yeah, I'll take it. Okay, and now what we're going to see is I'm going to do this subtraction down here. I'm going to take my f of x, right? We want to subtract f of x. So I'm going to rewrite f of x, but when I subtract it, right, what's going to happen? It's going to change the sign on each of these because what's minus f of x? It's the opposite. So each sign will change. So I get a positive 8, a plus 2x, and a minus, right? That's going to, a plus turns into a minus 3x. What you'll see is that the function itself always, there's part of it up here from the f of x plus h. There will always be a canceling. So that's why I kind of come here. And again, let me scoot out of the way. And so what I can do is, instead of writing all this horizontally and trying to work with it, I can just directly say, okay, negative 8 plus 8, that's 0. So I can sort of do this canceling. So that cancels, right? And this cancels. It's gone. And this cancels. It's gone. So the things that are left, a negative 2h, plus 6xh, and a 3h squared. So I'm just going to write that in the numerator. It's all still all over h, and we're still dealing with the limit as h goes to 0. And so we've got minus 2h, we have plus 6xh, remember that H can sort of, the division can distribute to each of these. So you could cancel out this H, cancel out this H, and cancel out one of these H. Or, if you prefer, and that's usually what the book will show, is you factor out an H to the front and then just cancel it once. Both ways work. For brevity of time and writing, I'm going to say that this H, I've got to cancel it. I've divided into each of these terms. Good. And then this one now becomes the H to the 1 power, not squared. But notice the H is out of here. It's a 1 if you want, but H is gone. What we now have is the limit as H goes to 0 of negative 2 plus 6 plus 3H. We can now let H go to 0 and it doesn't cause us an undefined answer, right? We don't have division by 0. So we do that and 3 times 0 is 0. And so our limit becomes, oops, I forgot the x. There it is. Our limit of this is going to become minus 2 plus 6x. And then, so that's really a formula, as we're going to see. That's a formula for the derivative, which is actually the next lesson, but we're okay. We're just a little bit ahead. And so what we can do here is plug in x equals 2. If you do that, you get negative 2 plus 6 as it heats up. Although I have a fan on it on the computer. Oops, not 6. There you go. It's 6 times 2, which is 12, and you might already be there. Minus 2 is 10. So this is the derivative function at 2 equals 10. And again, that's our slope, right? So what we're able to do is say that we've got, let me change colors here. Let's go with green. We've got y equals 10x plus b, which is the slope only at the point when x is equal to 2. And so y is 0. So now we can see what happens here. We get 10 times 2 plus b. And again, you can use the point slope formula if you prefer. So you get x equals 20 plus b. Subtract 20 from both sides. You get b is equal to negative 20. And that's what we got right here in this equation. So we would rewrite it simply as this. Notice we got this very quickly with a TI calculator, TI-84. My suggestion is use it to get it quickly. Do a little bit of practice just so this becomes part of your thinking and part of your way of doing. But yes, we will be moving more and more quickly into being able to calculate this 10. Either with some of the rules we come up with or certainly with our graphing calculators as well. And I think, what do we see if we got anything more going on? No, that's pretty much it. So using the technology, the draw button will actually draw the derivative. And the power it has to learn is it's easy. It gives you the answer. But more importantly, it gives you a visual. It shows you the tangent line. So you know you're getting the tangent line. The slope of that tangent line is the derivative. It's the rate of change. And hopefully makes those connections if you take the time to do that. Let's see. So let's click through here and see what we need to do. Derivatives and rates of change. So we did that. So now you're ready to really start working on the 10 questions in WebWorks. It's not due till the 13th, but if you could get working on it and have it done by the next class, that would be great. There's no class on Monday, on working on 2.2, and we'll be ready to go. All right. Thank you very much.